Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Alhamdulillah, we are live again with another session of Ask an Imam. So inshallah, I will be starting the program officially now. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah wa ashhadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Alhamdulillah, we are live again with another session of Ask an Imam, which is a program being organized by the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. The website being www.alislam.org. The format of the program is that in the first 10 to 15 minutes of the program, I would present a specific topic. And for today's topic, I have chosen an editorial published in Al-Hakam by the editor of Al-Hakam, in which during a daftari mulaqah, during an official meeting, he had the opportunity to ask some questions from Huzur Anwar Ayyadahullahu Ta'ala bin Nasr al-Aziz, Hazrat Amirul Mumineen, about what to do during times of trials, especially for our young generation. And then towards the end of the program, towards the second half, last 15 to 20 minutes, I will try to answer as many of your questions as I can to the best of my ability. And you can ask these questions by leaving comments on any of the platforms where you're watching this program, be it YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, etc. So without further ado, let me take you to the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. Again, the website is www.alislam.org. My name is Talha Ali, and I'm an imam or a missionary with the Ahmadiyya or a murabbi with the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, currently serving in the Philippines. So this is the home of the Al-Islam website. And since I will be presenting today from Al-Hakam newspaper of Jamaat, you can access Al-Hakam from Al-Islam's website as well. So you come to Al-Islam's homepage, you drag the page down, and then here you can find Al-Hakam. So if you click on Al-Hakam or Al-Fazl or the Review of Religions, the official web pages of these periodicals of the Jamaat should open up. So I have the Al-Hakam page open up, and here it says latest reporting the insightful words of Huzuri Anwar Ayyadahullahu Ta'ala bin Nasr al-Aziz. So from here, I wanted to just share some words of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih, which he shared with the editor of Al-Hakam newspaper, Al-Hakam magazine, Qasid Muin Sahib. Qasid Muin Sahib writes, so this article starts with, like, you know, the introduction that he had a meeting with Huzuri Anwar Ayyadahullahu Ta'ala bin Nasr al-Aziz, etc. And then this was an official mulaqat. And he went to the mulaqat and presented the matters pertaining to Al-Hakam. And then as the meeting came to a close, he had the opportunity to ask a question that he had been wanting to ask for past few days, actually many weeks. So he asked Huzur that in difficult circumstances, we find the energy to keep going only through Huzur's courage. But how does Huzur seek courage and solace? Huzur Ayyadahullah Ta'ala bin Nasr al-Aziz replied, Allah's Jamaat is bound to face challenging times. The enemies always attack divine communities. This is what we have always witnessed, and this is what we are witnessing now. We must remember and ask ourselves, who created this Jamaat? Did I make it, or did some other person? When Allah's promises are with the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, then why should we feel anxious and overwhelmed? Allah's promises are with the Jamaat, and so His promises shall come to pass. There is no reason to worry. Huzur continued, the Hazrat Nawab Mubarakah Begum Sahiba once wrote that jab nahi bolta banda to khuda bolta hai. That when man keeps silent, God speaks for him. Therefore, we must play our part all the while, protecting our faith and belief, and let God Almighty speak in favor of His Jamaat. Hazur said that Allah the Almighty's communities constantly remain a state of battle. Some from among the younger generations become worried too quickly. Those who have experienced similar challenging situations in the past, or who have studied even a bit of history do not feel anxious in such conditions. On such a battleground, one must stay alert rather than worry. The enemy gets irritated by anything we say. In fact, they get even more agitated by our silence. Nowadays, Huzur said, you are listening to the conditions of the companions of Rasulullah, Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and how vigilant they were in a state of battle. However, from the tone of the enemy these days, it is evident that they are losing their grip and control as they see their motives crumbling before them. So the editor sahib, respected editor of Al-Hakam magazine, Qasid Moin sahib, he asked Huzur that people from my generation, they tend to make hasty decisions. After hearing rumors from here and there, their opinions seem to waver. How can we help them understand the reality? And Huzur ayyadahu Allah ta'ala bin Hasil Aziz replied, it is necessary to speak to them. At such a young age, when one lacks knowledge and experience, the propaganda of our opponents can influence them. But it is essential to reach out and speak to them. In fact, Huzur said, before even speaking to them, it is essential to hear out and let them talk. There is an element of goodness in everyone, so they should be heard, and according to whatever they say, they should be spoken to, after which the element of good in them will ignite, and with God's grace, inshallah, they will be able to see the truth. So this was a brief discussion that the editor of Al-Hakam English magazine had with Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Al-Khamis, ayyadahullahu ta'ala bin Nasir Aziz, about what we should do during times of trials and tribulations. So if I can pick up one or two points from this, the main point would be what Huzur said, that jab nahi bolta banda to khuda bolta hai, that when man doesn't speak, God speaks for him. But for God to speak for us, it is very important that we develop a relationship with Allah the Almighty. And in one of my previous programs, I think last week, I did a program about how to become a Sultan-e-Nasir of Hazrat Amirul Mumineen or of Khilafat-e Ahmadiyya. And Huzur answered this question himself by saying, by developing a relationship with God through Nawafil prayer, Tahajjud being the best form of those Nawafil prayer. So if we want God to speak on our behalf, whatever difficulties we're going through, whatever challenges, whatever doubts, whatever, you know, crisis we're going through, it is Allah. And if we want Allah to speak on our behalf, and every believer would want that, that instead of them dealing with these issues, with these problems, Allah should deal with them. So the first and foremost responsibility of every believer should be to develop a relationship with Allah personally. So Allah Ta'ala gives us the strength as well. And then through that strength, inshallah, if as more members of the Jamaat have this relationship with Allah, inshallah, Allah Ta'ala's succor, Allah Ta'ala's help will come even faster. Second point that I found interesting in this very short discussion with Huzur was that it is very important to understand the history as well, and reading history. So I think that is something that a lot of us lack, and we should try to read about the history of Islam, history of Ahmadiyya, history of religion as much as we can. And lastly, the point Huzur mentioned, that it is very important to hear what other people have to say. Before speaking, we must hear out the complaint. We should understand what the issue is. And then we should try, to the best of our ability, to try to answer those issues, those questions that anyone may have. So this was the latest publication on Al-Hakam's website, which I saw this morning. I was planning to do the program on some other topic, but since I saw this, I thought that it would be prudent to discuss this topic before discussing any other topic. So now I would come towards the question and answer session. And in the last 20-25 minutes, I will try to answer, or as many questions there are, time permitting, I will try to answer them toward in this session of the program. So let me see the chats. First of all, wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu to all of you who have said salam. So actually, there are no questions so far. Mostly it's just the comments of assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. So wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. So as questions come in, I will try to answer them. Okay, so the first question has come in. It is from Muhammad Isa Sahib, who asks, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. How to talk to Allah the Almighty? I mean, if a person wants to talk to Allah the Almighty, just he speaks with his friend here on earth, how can I make myself able to do that? So first of all, we should understand that the mode of talking to Allah Ta'ala is different as opposed to how we talk to our friends. And it makes sense as well. Our friends are human beings just like us. They use the same means and modes of communication that we use. When I need to talk to a friend, I use my tongue. My voice travels through, the air. They're able to hear it with their eardrums. And then the language we use, it is man-made, etc., etc. The way to talk to Allah would obviously be different. Allah Ta'ala is not a human being. He does not have a tongue. He does not have an ear. So the mode of talking to Allah Ta'ala is obviously different. But Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam has written that I talk to Allah Ta'ala in a manner the way people talk to other people. Meaning, has written that when I lie down to sleep, sometimes I have such discussion I receive revelation in such a manner that Allah Ta'ala says something and then I reply back and then Allah Ta'ala answers that. So it's almost a discussion or a communication that we have with a friend. So that can happen. But it happens, the modes will be different, right? It will be through Wahi and Ilham of Allah. So before I answer how we can do that, just continuing on this discussion, how Allah Ta'ala talks to people, it's very interesting to note one of the first ahadith mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari. So the first chapter of Sahih al-Bukhari is called Kaifa Bada al-Wahi, how Wahi or revelation started for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. So the first hadith in that book is Innama al-amalu bin niyat. But if I'm not mistaken, the very next hadith, the second hadith, is from Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala. And she talks about how wahi, revelation or communication between Allah Ta'ala and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started. And she mentions that this communication between Allah and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started with Ruya Saliha. So we do not, most of us do not consider true dreams, Ruya Saliha, to be a form of communication. But in Sahih al-Bukhari, narrated by Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, it is mentioned that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who had the most closest relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even with him, it did not start right away with wahi of Allah or ilham of Allah. That is one of the highest stages, right? And we should endeavor to reach any stage that we can, but many of the people may not be able to reach that stage. But the lower stages of developing a relationship of Allah, communicating with Allah, are always open. And those lead to the next stages as well. Now to the question, how can we do that? So, of course, it's a long answer and it can be tackled from different angles. I will just try to focus on, I think, two main aspects of this question. One is what Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam has mentioned again and again, is that you can, when you talk to someone, you have a friend, that friendship is based on commonalities, right? You have something common with your friend. That is why you are able to communicate with them. You know, difficult topics, we cannot talk to anyone. The friend has to be very close to us. So that is only when we talk to them. So Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam has mentioned that the main way to have this relationship with Allah Ta'ala as well is by becoming same as Allah in a sense. In what sense? And Hazrat Musleh Maud Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu has explained this even more in many of his speeches, by incorporating or by manifesting the attributes of God. So Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam has explained that, you know, to have this relationship with Allah, we must have something common with Allah. That Allah Ta'ala only talks to pious, pure people. So if you're not pure, why would Allah Ta'ala talk to you? So how do we reach this stage of purity? Hazrat Musleh Maud Raziyallahu Ta'ala who has explained many times that it is through manifesting the attributes of God. So I think, so the answer is that we should become righteous, and by righteousness Allah will become our friend. So how to become righteous? And the answer becomes very long. So like I said, I will only like to focus on one or two points. So the first point is that we should try to manifest the attributes of God. If Allah Ta'ala is Rahim, He is merciful, we should be merciful to the creation of Allah. If Allah Ta'ala is Razak, Allah Ta'ala provides for people, we should provide for other people as well. If Allah Ta'ala is Sattar, He covers the shortcomings of other people, we should cover the shortcomings of other people as well. So more we manifest the attributes of God, more we are able to imitate the attributes of God, more we would become closer with Allah Ta'ala, and more Allah we would be able to develop a relationship with Allah. So that's one point. Second point is that Hazrat Musleh Maud Raziallahu Ta'ala who has mentioned that Allah Ta'ala communicates to people through Malaika. Right? Allah Ta'ala has mentioned in the Holy Quran that Allah Ta'ala speaks to people through various means, and one of those means is through Malaika. So Hazrat Musleh Maud Khalifatul Masih Sani radiallahu ta'ala anhu has also explained that by developing a relationship with the Malaika, with the angels, we can also we can communicate with Allah. So Hazur mentioned in his speech Malaikatullah, and if you have time you should read through that, but one point I would like to highlight from that which I found very beneficial is that Hazrat Musleh Maud radiallahu ta'ala anhu mentions that angels are associated with certain places and things. So, for example, one of the things he mentioned was that when you, the books which were written or the scriptures which were revealed by Malaika, or books which were written under the guidance of Malaika, or Malaika were present through their help, through their succor, through their, you know, through their support, when we read them, Malaika also descend upon us. So if we spend time in the worship of Allah, in the remembrance of Allah, and then in the reading of the Holy Quran, which was revealed by the Malaika, in the reading of the books of the promised Messiah, which were written with guidance from Allah Ta'ala through Malaika, then we would have developed this relationship with Malaika as well. So these are some ways. And then most importantly, which is basic, is Salat, right? Through 5 daily prayers, we develop this relationship. And through these 5 daily prayers, we talk to Allah Ta'ala. So like I said, in the beginning stages, Allah Ta'ala's way of talking are very simple. And even before Ru'ya Saliha, the way Allah Ta'ala start talking to us is by acceptance of prayer. So in our Salat, when we pray to Allah Ta'ala, Allah Ta'ala accepts our prayer, and that is a form of talking as well. I was reading a book just last night or the night before, in which Hazrat Musleh Maud Raziallahu Ta'ala anhu mentioned that people are always after Jantar Mantar, after some type of magical spell that would convert them into awliyaullah, into friends of Allah, and they're able to speak. And he quoted a very interesting quotation of Hazrat Masih Maud, the promised Messiah, that he said that people, they said that to develop a relationship with Allah, you should recite this prayer 100,000 times, this prayer 500,000 times, etc., etc. Hazrat said, Hazrat Masih Maud, the promised Messiah, said, sometimes I do tasbih one time, and because of that, I am able to develop a relationship with Allah. So one of the, Hazur said, I was not present in the meeting. Hazrat Musleh Maud Raziallahu Ta'ala who says that I was not present in that meeting. So I, one of the young people, he came to me. Hazur was young as well, because Hazrat Masih Maud is still alive. So Hazrat Musleh Maud is still 17 years of age at maximum. So the friend came and said, I heard this from Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, and I don't understand this. How can you do tasbih one time and you develop relationship? And Hazrat Musleh Maud Raziallahu Ta'ala who answered that I understand this 100%. That sometimes the tasbih comes from your heart. And even saying Alhamdulillah or Subhanallah or Allahu Akbar one time can give you that spiritual, pleasure or the spiritual fuel that you need to develop a relationship with Allah. And the person was so, you know, you can say he was so amused by this answer that he said, Hazur writes, that he said, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. To mock Hazrat Musleh Maud Raziallahu Ta'ala anhu, that, you know, I'm asking about how can we develop a relationship with Allah, and you're telling us this basic thing. Everyone knows this. So Huzur said that people are after these magical spells to develop a relationship with Allah. But there is no magical spell to develop a relationship with Allah. It starts from the basic, by praying 5 times a day, by doing zikr ilahi, by trying to inculcate the attributes of God, and by reading the books, scriptures of Allah, which He has revealed in the books of His chosen one, His sent prophets, etc. So these are some of the ways which I think can be beneficial in that regard. So some more questions have come so far. So, okay, I accidentally clicked on this. I have answered this question many times. Is bank job halal? In my opinion, yes, working in bank, for example, as a teller, etc., is allowed. If you have any specific question, or if you're not satisfied with this answer, you can write to Hazrat Khalifatul Masih. So you can send a letter. You can go to Al Islam's website, and over there, there's an option of how to write to Huzur. You can either mail in, or you can send through the fax, and you can ask for more detail about this question. But in my opinion, yes, working in the bank as a teller, etc., is allowed. It is not forbidden. There were some more questions before that. Sayyid Aqib Sahib, you asked me before last program as well, how to join Ahmadi community. And I mentioned that the best way to do, so administratively speaking, from a spiritual point of view, when you recite, you know, if you're a Muslim and then you believe in the Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad alayhi salatu wasalam to be the same Imam Mahdi and Masih Maud who was prophesied by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, then as, you know, then spiritually speaking, you become an Ahmadi. And once you believe in Khilafat Ahmadiyya, spiritually speaking, you're part of Ahmadi community. But from an administrative point of view, it needs to be done through the proper channels. You mentioned in the last program that you were from Pakistan. So I recommended that you must know at least one Ahmadi in your surroundings. If you don't, if you know that Ahmadi person, you should talk to him and you should ask him to guide you how to become an Ahmadi. He will, you know, because of security reasons, you know, it is difficult to share this information about Pakistan. But if you know an Ahmadi, maybe he can guide you better. He can take you to local sadr, local president, etc. If you don't know any Ahmadi, you can write to Huzur Anwar Ayyadahullahu Ta'ala bin Asil Aziz. And like I said, on Al Islam website, you can search how to write to Huzur and you can get the fax number and you can get the address and you can mail a letter or you can fax him and then he will guide you about how to deal with this matter. You can mention where you live, your phone number, your contact information, and somebody from your area can contact you. So because you're in Pakistan, it will be difficult for me to share the information of where community is. But Rabwa, you last time you also asked where is the headquarters. So Rabwa in Punjab near Chinyot is the headquarters of Jamaat in Pakistan. Muhammad Isa Sahib asks another question. He said that, is it sort of summary of the question, is it necessary for us to do good with person who is intentionally causing trouble to us? You do not have to associate with them anymore. Allah Ta'ala says again and again in the Holy Quran that when you deal with such people who are causing you trouble, you should separate yourself from them. So it does not mean that you should do harm to them, that you should try to hurt them. But Allah Ta'ala has said this in many places in the Holy Quran. So for example, in Surah Al-Furqan, Allah Ta'ala says, وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا. When jahil people, when ignorant people, they speak to them, they say, what is the reply of the believers? قَالُوا سَلَامًا. Assalamu alaikum. We don't want to talk to you anymore. They're separate. Another place Allah Ta'ala has said, when you come across such meetings where discussion is being done on things which are against Islam, then you should separate for yourself from those meetings, etc. So no, you do not have to associate with these people. If you're not associating with them, you're not dealing with them at all, whether in good or bad. So that is the teaching of the Holy Quran about dealing with such people who are causing trouble for you. Allah Ta'ala and Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam have told us again and again that we should not put ourselves in such situation which will cause harm to us. And there are many verses in the Holy Quran which highlight this point. So the best way to deal with such people, toxic people, is to separate yourself from them. Do not associate with yourself with them anymore. So if you're not associating with them, of course, you're not doing good or bad to them. But it does not allow us to do bad or hurt any person, even if they're causing trouble to us. What Islam teaches us is that we should separate ourselves from them. There's a question, what is the Ahmadi view on masturbation? So the Ahmadi view, of course, is based on the Holy Quran and the sayings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. So what you should understand is that Islam has not only forbidden us from zina, from sexual intercourse before marriage or adultery, but Islam has also told us that wala taqrabu zina, that do not even go near zina. So the philosophy of this thing is that Allah Ta'ala has given sexual powers and sexual desires to every human being, right? So some religions have come with the solution that we should follow rahbaniya, meaning celibacy. For example, in the Catholic Church, the priests, they're not allowed to marry. The nuns, they're not allowed to marry. They're not allowed to have any sexual relationship whatsoever. But Islam teaches us the point of view that all of our God-given faculties, all of our God-given powers, whether they be sexual powers, etc., they are from Allah Ta'ala. Only difference is, and they're not bad in themselves. Everything is good or bad depending on how we use it. And Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, has talked about this topic, the topic of things being good and bad depending on the situation, and also on the topic of sexual desires in his book, The Philosophy of the Teaching of Islam. I highly recommend that you should read that book, Philosophy of the Teachings of Islam. It is available on the Al-Islam website. Now, as for masturbation, the issue is that when you masturbate, you have to watch porn, or you have to use, you know, pornographical fantasies for the act of masturbation. So, for example, watching porn is completely forbidden in Islam, right? Allah Ta'ala tells us that we should do parda of the eyes, ghazay, basar, we should not do these things, we should not go near zina. So it falls under that. So porn, all the ulama agree, is not allowed in Islam. It is haram. So for masturbation, you have to rely on that. So because of that, masturbation also become haram, or it also becomes, like, you know, unlawful, because of the fact that you have to rely on porn. So even if you're not watching porn, you have to, you know, create some kind of mental pornographic images for you to get through the act. And that is the same thing, that you are, like, you know, you are imagining things which Allah Ta'ala has told you not to imagine or not to do. So because of these reasons, masturbation is also unlawful, in the sense that it forces us to use these things, right? Now, like I mentioned earlier, that sexual desires are not bad in themselves. And as young people, we have these desires, and sometimes it is very hard to control them. So what should we do? So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself has taught us that the best way to deal with these sexual frustrations, sexual desires, is either to get married at a young age, so we can relieve our sexual desires, or we can fulfill our sexual desires by means which have made lawful by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or Hazrat Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that if one of you does not have the capacity to get married, then they should fast. And Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, has also focused on the importance of fasting. That first of all, you should try to get married if you have these desires and you are unable to control them. And all of us have these desires. There's nothing to be ashamed of. These desires in themselves are not bad. And then if you cannot get married, then you should fast. Fasting helps you in curbing these desires. And then lastly, in that book which I suggested to you, The Philosophy of the Teachings of Islam, Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam has also talked about that when Allah Ta'ala says, وَلَا تَقْرِبُوا الزِّنَا, do not go near zina. So there are certain things which make us more prone to masturbation or illicit relationships, etc. So if you are struggling with this, if you're struggling with masturbation, one of the things you can do is, what I mentioned is early marriage, fasting, and then also to stay away from things which incite this kind of behavior, which is very difficult, I understand. When you go to college, when you're watching TV, there are many, you know, triggers that are always there, which make it very difficult. But we can limit them, right? We can try to reduce the amount of these triggers that we have in our life. So what kind of programs we're watching, what kind of shows we're watching, what kind of movies we're watching, are we focusing on Ghazay Basar or not, etc. So these are some of the suggestions on how we can help curb the habit of masturbation. But masturbation is unlawful because it has to be done through pornographical means, which are forbidden in Islam. So I hope I was able to answer your question. So a question has been asked, can I comment on the age of Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam? So the age of Hazrat Nuh, Prophet Noah alayhi salatu wasalam, has been mentioned in the Holy Quran as 900 years, right? 900 plus years. So our understanding of that is that it does not make any sense, according to history, according to other verses of the Holy Quran, etc., for Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. And also, you know, logically speaking, Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam was physically 900 years. If you go to the Al-Islam's website, let me share with you, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Rabi rahmatullah alayhi has given a very interesting answer, detailed answer to this question, and I think that will be beneficial of you. I will try to summarize that answer for you, and then you can also listen to it yourself. So if you go to Al-Islam's website, there is an option here of Ask Islam. These are basically clips from question and answer session of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Rabi, Rahmatullah. How many years did Noah live according to the Quran? So if you click on this, there is a 6-minute answer which Huzur has given on this topic. So Huzur explains that logically and from the Holy Quran itself, it does not make sense for Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam to be 900 plus years. And the reason for that is, if Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam was of that age, then Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam would have, his time period, his life, would have overlapped many of the other prophets which are mentioned, including Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. But we know from the Quran that Allah Ta'ala says that Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam was not, he was from his Shiatihi, meaning he was from his group, but he was following his, from his Sharia, but he was not alive during the time of Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. And also logically speaking, it does not make any sense that Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, was alive for 900 plus years. So our understanding of the age of Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, which is mentioned in the Holy Quran, is that it was the age of Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam's Sharia and Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam's dispensation. So Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam was from the group of Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, was following the Sharia of Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. And then some ulama are of the opinion that at the latter part of Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam's life, he was given his own Sharia. Right? So this is a matter of dispute whether Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam brought a Sharia or not. But he was from the Sharia of Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, which is mentioned clearly in the Holy Quran. So our understanding is that 900 plus years is actually the age of the dispensation or the Sharia of Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, not his physical age. And then you can listen to the answer of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Rabi, Rahmatullah alayhi, in this topic as well. Second question by the same questioner is, where does Allah state or show us in the Quran that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is not the last prophet? So first of all, the question is, where does Allah Ta'ala says in the Holy Quran that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is the last prophet? Only verse where Allah Ta'ala has mentioned, which people try to understand as last prophet, is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam being khatamun nabiyyin. And khatam does not last. Khatam means seal of the prophet. So, and many of the previous ulama were of the opinion, or they have mentioned this opinion, that khatamun nabiyyin does not mean the last prophet. What it means is that he was the seal of the prophets. He was the greatest of the prophets. All of the kamalat, all of the qualities or the great characteristics of the prophets reached their apex in the person of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then there are many proofs that Khatamun Nabiyyin does not mean the last prophet. Even from Arabic language, Khatamun Nabiyyin, when this specific tarkib, this specific structure is used, when the word Khatam is muzaf, and then, the Muzafe ilayh is a plural in the form of Nabiyyin. So for example, Khatamul Mufassirin, Khatamul Atibba, etc., etc. It's a plural. It is always used in the meaning of best. So Hazrat Muhyiddin ibn Arabi rahimahullah has been called Khatamul Mufassirin, right? Hazrat Ali raziyallahu ta'ala anhu is called Khatamul Awliya by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself, etc. So that's the first point. Where does Allah Ta'ala say in the Holy Quran that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the last prophet? Only mention is Khatamun Nabiyyin, and this is a matter of dispute among us and among the other people. So other than Khatamun Nabiyyin, where does Allah Ta'ala says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the last prophet? Having said that, there are many verses of the Holy Quran which tell us that prophethood has continued among the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I will present to you just one verse for the sake of brevity. That is Surah An-Nisa, chapter 4, verse number 70. Allah Ta'ala says in that verse, وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْأَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالصَّالِحِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءَ وَالصَّالِحِينَ وَحَسُنَ أُولَٰئِكَ رَفِيقًا. Chapter 4, verse number 70. Now, Allah Ta'ala says in this verse very clearly that those who follow Allah and those who follow this prophet, meaning Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There's another verse of the Holy Quran where instead of al-Rasulu, Rusul is mentioned, plural is mentioned. That those who follow Allah and those who follow prophets, over there the prophet, the promise of Nabuwa, of prophethood, is not mentioned. But here in this verse of the Holy Quran, Allah Ta'ala says that those who follow Allah and those who do ata'at of Rasulullah Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Al-Rasul, they will be مَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ, they will become from the group of people who Allah Ta'ala has bestowed His blessings upon. And then Allah Ta'ala explains who are the people who Allah Ta'ala will give these blessings. They are the group of النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وحسن أولئك رفيقا. That whoso obeys Allah and His Messenger, he shall be among those on whom Allah has bestowed His blessing, namely the prophets, the truthful, the martyrs, and the righteous. And excellent companions are these. So in this verse of the Holy Quran, Allah Ta'ala has mentioned very clearly that the door of prophethood is open. Muslims, believers, anyone who believes in Allah and Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Hazrat Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and they do their ata'at, meaning they're completely obedient to them, then all four of these, you know, categories of in'am, of blessing from Allah, is open from them. The category of prophethood, the category of siddiqeen, shuhada, and salihin. And Allah Ta'ala has very clearly put the word min with all four of them. So some people say that Allah Ta'ala has used the word ma'a here, that they will be with them. So this question, if you can read the commentary of this verse, but I will try to answer the best as well, but you should also read the commentary of this verse as well from Al-Islam's website. So some people raise a counter allegation or counter, you know, point about this verse, that Allah Ta'ala has used the word ma'a, that they will be with them. They will be not be from among them, but be with them. But that is a misunderstanding of the Arabic word. Allah Ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, we pray, Allah Ta'ala has taught us this prayer in Surah Ali Imran, وَتَوَفَّنَا مَعَ الْأَبْرَارِ, that, oh Allah, cause us to die among the righteous. Now, does the word ma'a, تَوَفَّنَا مَعَ الْأَبْرَارِ, does that mean that we are to die next to the righteous people but not be among them? So the word ma'a has been used in the meaning of min in the Holy Quran in hundreds of places, in many places. So the word ma'a does not, this is one counterpoint that is raised by non-Ahmadis, that ma'a does not mean from them but with them, right? But Allah Ta'ala has not only, first of all, this allegation is wrong, and secondly, Allah Ta'ala has used the word min and then used all four of these following the same Arab as this one, right? So meaning this min applies to all four of these categories. So if we cannot have the in'am or the blessing of prophethood, then by that logic, whatever logic you're using to say that Nabiyeen is not part of this verse, then Siddiqeen is also not part of this verse. Shuhada is also part of not part of this verse. Salihin is not part of this verse. So na'uzu billah, what kind of ummah has been given to Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that it cannot even have righteous people or martyrs or truthful people, right? So this is one of the verses, and there are other verses of the Holy Quran as well, which highlight the point that the door of prophethood is open among the ummah of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. But again, my first point still stands. Where does it say in the Holy Quran that no prophet can come after Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? And then just to finish this point, one small bit as well. Even our differences of understanding with non-Ahmadi, and this is the point I personally like to highlight the most. This is the point that makes sense to me the most, right? That whatever definition of last prophet that is done by our non-Ahmadi ulama friends, our non-Ahmadi friends, that definition is the same at the end of the day. There might be some semantics involved, there might be some mental gymnastic involved, but at the end of the day, the definition is the same. As long as they believe in the second coming of the Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. And the second coming of Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wasalam is mentioned in many of the authentic in all of the authentic books of ahadith, right? So the only difference among us and among the non-Ahmadi Muslim is not about the definition of whether another prophet can come after Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam or not. The only difference is whether the person who will come, he will be someone who will be given the name of Isa ibn Maryam and be born among the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or whether he would be Isa ibn Maryam who is alive in heaven. Otherwise, they also believe a prophet can come, right? They also believe Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will be coming back at the latter age. So it's not a difference of opinion whether a prophet can come or not. It is a difference of opinion whether that prophet will be the prophet of Bani Israel who Allah has called Rasulun ila Bani Israel in the Holy Quran, or would that be from the Ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And there are a lot of resources available on Al Islam's website for this question. So if you want to do further study, just type. There's a tag as well of Khatamun Nabiyyin, I think, on the Al Islam website. Let me share with you quickly. So if you're interested in further studies, you can read that. So this was the Holy Quran, but if you go to homepage of Al Islam, one of the topics so finality of prophethood. So right here, select the topics, finality of prophethood. So if you click on this, you have all of these resources. There's a book from B.A. Rafiq Sahib, that chapter is quoted, and if you come all the way down, you can benefit from other resources that are available here as well. Okay, so you can partake from these resources that are available to you. So Jazakumullahu ta'ala asil Nizam for joining me today. So inshallah, I will be stopping here. May Allah ta'ala bless us all, and may Allah ta'ala enable us to worship Allah in a manner that is accepted by Him and that brings us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah ta'ala make it so for me and for all of us. Ameen. Allahumma ameen. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammad wa barik wa sallim innaka hamidu majid. I've already read Durood Sharif, but there's a question, is Dini Malumat available in English? Dini Malumat, actual book, I don't think has been translated in English, but I know that Atfalul Ahmadiyya Canada once was translating it as well. So there are some reasons, you should contact Atfalul Ahmadiyya Department of US, of Canada for sure, because I know Canada was working on it, and I think maybe UK as well. So you may be able to find some resources, but I will look into it if it is available or not. So again, Jazakumullahu ta'ala asil niza. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.